since now we have to make exactly,
yes, you
are not bound anymore to other so we have the desktop applications that all the future gateway, the API, and then turn on whatever we can run, great files over there.
Actually, this is something that we need to reach out before we finish.
Them to more time to
Quindi io macchina messa a mano, scorta che sono a casa, quindi devo dire che poi inizia purtroppo,
I ran to the administration. They called them back and then they managed to do it. Could you open a web browser? Or is it complicated? Just to show the agenda, I'm going to show the agenda before you start. So you do agenda.ct, agenda.ct, okay, go, and then scroll down, until Sci-GaIA, a little bit, okay, this one. Go here, then you do trains, okay. Then you do Dear Summer Hackfest, and then you do everybody has to sign. So if you did, because we need daily signature. Sorry about that, guys. We need everybody to sign to witness that you attended the session. This is important for the commission. Allora, oggi ci saranno solamente slide. Però, quindi, solamente qua e il più
largo. Sì,
andiamo a
perdere. Ok? No, ho messo l'altro per fare una casa e l'altra scheda a casa, quindi non ci voglio tornare, ora sistemo le cose. Quando proprio sono interessato. Non mi capita mai, sono
di un'altra parte. Hai detto cose che...
Sì, sono stanca, vedi, non lo fanno.
Okay, so this is the SSID and the password for the network. We also get it wrong, but it's a little bit shaky because there's a problem. The university has a problem with one of the servers. So if you can, if you cannot connect it to Edurom, that's the dedicated Wi-Fi access. Simon and Anastasia, there are plugs under your table. Find the closest ones, and also on the other side. Okay. Oh, sorry. I'm in the middle of the streaming. We are streaming already, right? Okay. Mario, can you tweet that we are going to start in 5 minutes? Okay. I think we can start because I know that people from Africa are stuck in the bank, so they will be late. Okay, so good morning, everybody, and welcome to the third day of the Summer Hackfest. In the first 2 days, we listened to tools and technologies. Now the word is with the use cases and with the different applications. I got several contributions, but I know for sure that they are not all of them. So here I put some the order. I put the candidate, the selected candidate from Africa later, and I try to put together contributions sharing belonging to the same domain. Each of the presenters has half an hour. So I've seen some of the slides. I mean, some covers will cover half an hour, some will not, but I hope that there will be discussion, especially between the presenters and the developers of the tools that the presenters will say they are going to use. Okay? So the first speaker today is Andy Alec from the Polytechnic University of Valencia, Spain. And he will tell us about error correction of NGS data. So Andy, half an hour. If you finish earlier, we will discuss, okay? You put your microphone, is it on?
Yes.
Okay. And the other microphone for the streaming, is it also there? Okay, great. Whenever you want.
Okay. So, hello everybody. I'm Andy. I'm a bioinformatician and software engineer. I'm working at the University of Politecnica de Valencia, and today I'll present what I've done, my PhD thesis, and what I would like to do with technology presented here at this conference. Right, so basically, these are the topics I will discuss today. The scientific problem, what I have implemented regarding the error correction. Then I will tell a little bit what I plan to implement with what I understood from the tools. I will show see that. And I will end with the summary and okay, so basically something is about the problem. So sequencing is reading DNA, RNA from our cells, or so to speak, digitalizing the data, the chemical data of the cell. The first generation appeared in 1977, and Felix Sanger was the inventor and got Nobel Prize for that in chemistry. Then the second generation appeared in about 2005, because the first part was kind of slow and tedious and quite expensive, so something better was needed. As an example, it's not on the slide, but it's a good example, of the first human genome was sequenced using the first generation, whatever it means. And basically, they needed 10 years and many billions of dollars. Now we can, with the latest instrument, we can do that for about $1,000. It was a huge leap forward. And finally, the third generation, with longer reads, so basically we can read longer parts of the DNA, appeared in about 2009. Now, what's the whole idea? The sequencing, basically, what you have to know is that you can read the whole chromosome, the whole genome. So what you have to do is you have to cut it in segments, short segments. So, and you are eating those segments, and then, I know it's not very safe, but this is the technology we have right now, you have to put those segments together. In order to put those segments together, you have to create reads that overlap. So, as you can see, it will be later, you have to read the same repeated multiple times. Reconstruct genes. whole idea is why this problem is related to this conference, because we are talking about big data. So the human genome has about 1.5 billion terabytes. And to sequence it, we are generating tens of gigabytes to 1.5 gigabytes, depending on the coverage, depending how many times we are in the search terrain. And the human genome is far away from the largest on Earth. So basically, the largest has about 600 billion terabytes. So that's a lot of data. One of the largest organisms that has been sequenced is a plant. The plants that normally have larger genomes. And one of the labs has 22 billion of terabytes. And in this case, we're talking about terabytes of data. So, a lot of data. Okay, so here's an example. Of course, I don't have enough space to do the genome, so this is a part of this case, E. coli. And those are some very short reads. In reality, the reads are longer, but I don't have enough space on the slide. So as you can see, what the machine is doing is reading all these samples. And then, as you may see, you see overlap. So what you have to do, basically when the overlap is easy to do, the computer will do that with the overlaps and you put them together and recreate the initial gene. So this is sequencing. Hopefully in the next 5 years we'll have something to sequence the whole gene. Okay, so this is not anymore a research topic, so this is in the university. We are talking about application in the medical and biological fields, and some of the applications are error correction, genome assembly, about genomes and compared genomes, variation detection, for instance, we sequence humans and want to see the difference between different humans. They are susceptible to a certain type of cancer, for instance, or they have an effect on the genetic code, so we compare them. Cancer research, of course, you have to see the mutations in the genes to see what caused the cancer. And comparative genomics, for instance, humans against chimpanzees, to see the difference. Okay, as I said, it is used in medicine and biology, and for instance, cancer mutations and you are working in different fields, but I suppose that everyone wants data of the highest quality possible. So error correction is quite an important step in all domains, and it's the same here in next-generation sequencing. The idea is to repair whatever the sequencer was unable to read or read neurons. And basically, this is the first step. All the others need high quality data, detect variations or whatever. So you do the correction and then you do whatever you best want with the data. For this, I implemented during my PhD nothing in C, which is a quite general corrector, which supports multiple technologies, all types of errors. And the general idea is that it's using KMOS. I'll explain what KMA is, group the reads, as you have seen, you have to return the overlaps between the reads, so you have to group them together. And then create a multiple sequence alignment. You'll see a little later what's that, group correct. What's a KMA? Basically, a KMA is a subsegment of a read. Here is an example for KMA. The idea is I don't need just one segment to do it, I need the whole set for the reads. And as you have seen from the overlapping reads, you can imagine that we generate all the subsegments of the reads, then we can find relations between reads, because in the ideal case, the game appears in one location. That's the very ideal case if you don't have any advantage for the set. So it gives us relationships. And the program has been published in Information Science, as we see. Okay, so talking about stages, talking about a little bit about the corrector. Basically has about five stages. The first one is generate the K-mos, basically generate the subsegments for the reads. And this one will generate basic groups, relationships between reads, so subsegments that are common to different reads. Next, because the K-mos is quite short, it's normally what the pretty much you normally say 10 pleiotids or 13 pleiotids, that's quite a good number. We have to find more than one K-mos to be sure that the reads are really related and not just create groups, just to create groups. And in this case, I'm using a multiple K-mos approach to create reading groups. Why they are reading groups? Because once the read enters the group, it is marked and it won't enter other groups. So basically, a group is in one and only one. A read is in one and only one. Okay, the next step is basically generate the multiple sequence alignment. Just a little bit of that. Basically, it's put stack the reads on one of the others and correct them. I'm using the Smith Waterman to define the group because the previous method, which was creating the reading groups, is not very exact, and some reads that have common parts might may end up together, so we have to separate them to be able to perform the correction. So okay, let's define groups, and then once we are sure that the reads are really part of the same genomic location locus, we correct. So basically, we apply a correction method on each defined group, and the correction is quite fast. We search for the base with the highest count on each one, and that should be the correct one. Of course, the user can alter the exact percentage of the correct base. And finally, the last stage is to generate the reads, the initial reads. As I said, I'm trying to correct the errors. I'm not doing assembly or rebooting or something else. I'm just trying to correct assembly, and maybe the users later on they need the reads as they were initially. I mean, their size, they don't need to do so they generate the correct reads. And I said, okay, so talking about multiple sequence alignment. This is a multiple sequence alignment on the upper part. You can see what the computer sees, counter. We have four nucleotides, A, C, G, D, and cut down on unknown case, and the sequence I couldn't read the data, and have the missing with the hyper. On the lower part, you can see what we are thinking about the multiple sequence alignment, and basically the reads stack on one on top of the other. In this case, I also have some case of errors. For instance, the first column that is marked is an A and G. I can't take a decision, it's 50-50, so I just skip it. The second case, C is the falling base, and G will become C. In the third case, the blue column, M is unknown, and the other case have a T in the same position, so T is the point. And the orange should be that. The orange case, G is the point one. The pink case, basically purple, we have an insertion in the read, so it's a bad base, we have to read it. And finally, on the last column, it's orange, but should be red, depending on the color, we have a deletion in the first read. So we insert the seat. Alright, so right now the algorithm is implemented in OpenMP and MPI. It's high performance, and each read group, so basically for the second stage, is sent to a particular thread or node and the case, and it's going to be there, or refined and then correct. And right now, we avoid a lot of communication between the nodes. We save the voidity complete. But it basically is ready and each node saves complete, doesn't send back to the center. Right, another important thing, especially for this conference, talking about big data, is that data is stored on hard drive. So it's not flowing into the memory, because as I said, we're talking about a lot of memory. And the idea of the project is that it should run on personal computers, so it shouldn't eat a lot of RAM. And basically what I'm keeping in the memory is the relationship between the reads and the byte things, of course. And the reads are represented by IDs, as we shall see in the next slide. The reads are not ASCII characters. Okay, so input and output. Normally in bioinformatics, the most general case is FASTA and Pascal. We have simple text files. In case of FASTA, we have the ID of the read and the read itself. So basically, you have two or more lines. Why? Because the reads can be split on multiple lines. So when you're reading a file, you count the file in multiple lines. And then we have the newer format, which is the FASTQ, in which you have the ID, the read, and you also have the quality score. What is the quality score? Basically, when the machine is reading a certain position, it also assigns a percentage of that position to be right. That's the quality score. Okay, so talking about to be implemented, I'll be here only for 2 days, tomorrow and Friday. And, well, first I'll try to use Ovidia, the framework, to do the KMR count and maybe correct the reads using the KMRs, so searching low count KMRs. I have to see how to do it. And to check if the implementation should be better than using MPI or REST, because you are talking about big data and storing the cloud, so maybe if I'm working in cloud, you know, this should be better and faster. I don't know if this one. And on the second day, well, as I said, we're talking about terabytes of data, so we can't expect the user to store it on their hardware. We need something to mount it on the local hard drive, and I think one data should be a good choice. You'll see how it works. Normally what I need is initial streaming of a file, and then the program should extract this data and keep it locally on the hard drive. So it should be initial streaming and that's it. But depends on the application. In my case, just read the data once, create a KMR table, and that's it. The user can play with the different parameters from that point on. And what? Well, see it works. And what? Well, finally, the execution of jobs is needed in this case, part of the masses. After I finish the first code. Okay, summary conclusions. Basically, as I said, the sequencing data is used in medical and biological fields. It's quite important. We're talking about big data with errors, and what is good if we can correct them. I presented my work, mapping PC, the error corrector. I'll try to use OPDI1 data to learn the power of cloud and distributed computing, or cloud, because you have API already for PC to read, and large on the method to provide execution environment. I said there maybe should be an important point. The challenge is putting everything together. So there are many parts. Yes, there are many parts. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Andy? Questions for Andy? I got two questions actually. One, I didn't understand from your presentation how are you going to steer your calculation. So you have a web portal, you have an application, you use command line.
I have an application command line.
Okay. But would you be interested in having a graphic application, or your community is satisfied with the command line?
Right now in command line, because basically it's a batch application, you don't need something to visualize.
Okay.
You don't have what to visualize.
Can you talk a little bit about how you're moving data in and out, how often the data is changing? I think I missed it in the slides, but so I'm thinking, like, is this a streaming application? Is it you said it's batch, right? So how often is that data changing? And
so basically, right now in the implementation, input file is read 3 times.
Okay.
Because the first time I have to allocate the memory to know how many cables I have, right? How many subsegments. Then I have to basically create the structure for the cables to reads. And then I have to correct the reads.
Okay. So 3 processing jobs for a single set of data?
Yes, you can call it like that.
Okay. And how many sets of data do you expect to have? Like, what's the long term use case?
So, how many sets? It's 1 set of data, but it can increase in size.
Okay. So, I'm not a biologist, so what is in this data? It's a sequence of like an animal or a protein?
Yes, there are subsegments of the DNA.
Okay.
Is the DNA or RNA, not the proteins.
Right.
So basically, let's consider that there's the genome and these are the segments. Because you can't read the genome, the whole genome. So you have the segment of the genome and read those segments. And then I can put them here.
Yeah, I'm just trying to figure out like how often, what's changing between runs. This is the data set has to change between runs, then that's always the same data set.
So you can use a caching strategy.
Sure. And are you pulling it in from a database that's like an NHS or somewhere?
Yes, in my case for the test, yes. But normally the application is made for biologists from raw data that are obtained for sequencers.
Okay. So it comes off the sequencer.
Exactly.
Okay. And have you thought about how to kind of pull that in? Like, I don't know how the sequences works, but I can imagine they store the data onto a local cache. So is that working? Like, can you read data directly from the sequencer?
Right from sequencer, no. The sequencer is generating fast files.
Okay.
Like a hard drive or the cloud,
and then you just move
machine,
it around.
And then you have to read streaming sequencers, not very well, because they are quite expensive.
Yeah,
so you have to store the data to be sure and you don't have to run again.
Okay.
So it strikes me that for this to be fast, the data source and the compute element needs to be close. Otherwise, it's going to be communication with that. But are you looking at trying to use any pipeline to speed up the processing of the sequencing data? So for example, you've got several compute modules running in parallel, taking elements of the data out and processing that in parallel. I missed the beginning of your talk. So have you given any thought to that, to try and speed up the streaming and the processing?
Yes, what we can do, for instance, you can speed the input data and generate the cable tables for each node and then bring them together, for instance.
Yeah, so I'm thinking about the parallelism, because if you've got one data source, you're then taking the data out of that and waiting. Then you're processing it, and then you putting it somewhere else and waiting. That's a lot of waiting time.
There's the thing, it depends. For instance, when we are doing on local or on our class or on our NPI cluster, we don't have a problem because the correcting process is slow enough to overlap and the generation of the key table is slow enough to overlap the reading. But that's in our case. I didn't try with many terabytes of data.
You're looking at cloud,
aren't you? Yes, I would like to take a look at cloud. The problem is with cloud is that manual, for instance, Spark, has a lot of things like encryption, all this stuff that is not needed in my case. And I tried, for instance, to do the game accounting in Spark, and it took like 35 minutes on a 8-core CPU on local, so basically I run Spark locally on a local machine. And with C++, we multi-thread, it took about 1.2 minutes.
So it has a lot of... Presumably a lot of that is loading up the virtual machine and waking up and loading, but a little bit of processing and then finishing.
Yes, I suppose that. I'm not really sure why, but it was so slow that I said, okay, we're going to C++.
Well, maybe look at boosting up the cloud instance earlier, so it's ready for you, and then do it. You might get some performance increase.
I have tried, yes. This time, see if I can implement something that can be scaled. Because basically, with MPI, if the program is made for MPI, it won't scale well in the cloud. Can we make a general program? Yes, but it won't work very well in the grid because the grid is very fast. So there are different cases. So I'm trying now to move from the grid.
I've never tried large instances with MPI.
We try with tens of gigabytes. That's it. Tens of gigabytes.
Now CPUs.
With CPUs. Well, 4 cores, 8 nodes.
Okay, I think you see some benefit when you get to 34 or 64. So 32 or 64.
It should scale.
Yeah. I think you'd be happier when you get up to that number of CPUs.
The only thing I'm afraid of is the overhead that can be introduced by the cloud technologies. For instance, they are checking the nodes that are alive. The MPI doesn't. It dies. Right.
Yeah. You mentioned that you wanted to use Ophidia, right?
Yes.
But that reminded me that you need to split the data to use this kind of MapReduce.
Yes.
How do you do that? How do you split the data across the nodes?
To split the data, basically, I'll split in equal sizes, and I will generate the schema table for each chunk.
Okay. So
and then I have to merge
it together. Okay. So yeah, seems like a pretty typical, like, distributed batch applications. Why are you using MPI?
Well, I'm using MPI because my PhD was in distributed computing.
Okay. Right? And what messages are you passing to use MPI?
In case of MPI, I'm passing the groups, the IDs of the groups. And basically, each node on the MPI has the file or has access to the file. And you can explain that.
Okay. All right, so you got like a coordinator which says, okay, you know,
yes,
go do your thing, let me know when you're finished.
Splitting that.
Yeah. I mean, it just seems like knowing the little that I know about sequencing data, you can literally just split it up however you like. So maybe you go even faster if you don't use any message passing or any coordination, you just stream the data. And wherever you get a slot available, you process it.
Yes.
So I think maybe a video would be much faster then. You don't have any kind of central lock, you know? I don't know, just an idea.
Yeah.
Any other questions for Andy? Comments?
Just
a comment. No, please.
Because you cited Marathon.
Can you speak louder?
Okay, you talked about Marathon and Mesos.
Yes.
I think that being a batch jobs, the best technology should be Kronos on top of Mesos. You should benefit from one of the features of Kronos framework, which is the management of dependencies among jobs if you don't use MPI. If you run in parallel many jobs and then you have to merge the results of these jobs, you can manage the dependencies of the last job from all the others that started before. And you should also benefit from one of the features of the Indigo Pass, which is one data for the data storage and for the data locality, because the pass orchestrator will be able to allocate the compute resources closer to the data this is, I think this is an important feature.
Actually, I said before that I had two questions and I asked just one. The second is, according to your computing model, you just submit one job that acts on one data set.
Exactly.
Or you can organize your tasks, your job in a workflow. So I'm wondering if a workflow can be beneficial for your...
If I split the program, but now the program is a C++ program which does all the steps.
Okay. So you can have an internal workflow inside your process. Okay. Okay. Okay, so I think that we can move on. Thank you very much, Andy. And, we now move from bioinformatics to climate, if I'm not mistaken.
Okay.
With Alge Bloom case study, managing data from models. And this is, the speaker is Fernando Aguilar from ISTA. So you should connect this.
Yes.
Do you need any adapter?
I think it's DVI.
Yes. So, well, let me use this. I can give you, okay, let me use this, I'll bring you the adapter. You have this port on your computer, right? So,
yes.
Okay.
I'm gonna try it, but
yes. Okay. Connect. And who's this? Yours? Okay. 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 Okay, whenever you want.
So let me start. So good morning to everyone. My name is Fernando Aguilar. I work in at IFCA, that is a institute from the Spanish National Research Council. And I'm going to talk about my use case, that is Alge Bloom. It is also included in the Water Cloud project as one of the case studies. So this work is under the framework of our set community, that is LifeWatch. LifeWatch is an esprit oriented to biodiversity and ecosystems research. Now it's becoming an ERIC, so it's is going to be an institution by itself soon. Under LifeWatch umbrella, many different projects will be supported, both on basic and applied research. There is a number of different projects within the LifeWatch context and the different national LifeWatch initiatives. This case study, and in particular, on the modeling of a water reservoir and prediction of algae bloom, is a collaboration of IFCA and a small enterprise called Ecohydros, that is from Spain also, and working for the CHD, that is the river water. It is a long collaboration, more than 10 years, and many steps have been given. For example, we deployed and integrate a complex remote instrumentation. I will show later the platform that we have in the middle of the reservoir with a lot of instrumentation. We have performed a system of data taking and visualization. It is accessible via web for the stakeholders, the people from the company and the people from the water authorities.
We model the whole system, including the hydrological and biological model. We are using the Dev3D software suite, that is a software that includes many different models for water mass, like rivers, sea, or lakes, or reservoir. And we need the validation of the model and a predictive system. The Arduino, I want to explain later what is the problem, are due to amplification problems and pointer problems in water quality management. There are different stakeholders and interests, for example, the authorities, in terms of local, regional, national, or European level, and researchers on the water system as a basic framework for modeling and simulation of hydrological systems. We are trying to develop new maintenance station in systems in other lakes or other water reservoirs. So, as introduction, as I said, the framework is the collaboration with that company within a European Life Plus project called REN Plus. It was ending this year, but all the information is available. We want to model the reservoir in two parts. First of all, the hydrodynamical, that is the physical parameters of the water, like temperature, the water level, and so on. And the water quality model, that is in terms of chemical or biological parameters of the water. I will explain later what kind of parameters we are modeling. In particular, the reservoir is called Cuerda del Pozo, that is placed at Soria, close to a city of Spain. And this reservoir is for water supply and also for water activities. As we said, this collaboration is a long collaboration for more than 2 years. In this picture, we can see the platform that is in the middle of the water, and it takes different values of different parameters, physical, chemical, or biological parameters. And it allows to know what is the status of the reservoir. And we have data taken since 2010. We have a data visualization tool that is able to show the different parameters taken by the instrumentation in the platform. And it tends to alert authorities when the water quality is under the limits. On the right, we can see a chart of, in this case, is the algae concentration. We have a color system where the authorities can check what is the status of the water. If the color is blue, everything is okay. But when the color is yellow or red, something is happening. In this case, algae bloom. It can be dangerous for the water supply and or the activities that are being doing in the reservoir. So, until this, we have real-time data, but we want to do one more step. That is, knowing before an event, in this case, an algae bloom happens, the status of the water using modeling tools. Modeling with the modeling, we can forecast the status of the water reservoir and be sure that something is going to happen soon. In this case, we have this Dev3D model. I will explain later how it works. The goal is alert authorities not only in real time but before an alert happens. And the problem is the replication. When the water temperature increase and the concentration of different nutrients comes to the reservoir, it causes an increase in feed plankton. This feed the algae and it starts to grow. So if the concentration of algae is too high, the water quality is worse. And some different species of algae could cause that the water is toxic. So if the vegetation is high, it could be a problem for the water supply. This is an example in 5 years of continuous monitoring in this reservoir. This is the cyanobacteria concentration. This is not something that happened every year, but in some particular situation of the water reservoir, it happened. But for instance, we had a water bloom in 2010, another one in 2015. With different algae species. Both of them could be toxic. So, as we can see, in 2010, the algae bloom was very important. Regarding computing and data model, we have this Delta3D system for modeling. It is separated in two different parts. The first one is the hydrodynamic. This model is called Delta3D flow, and we have performed it in different resolutions. For instance, from 5 to 14 meters horizontally, and from a half and 3 meters vertical, in 35 different layers, vertical layers. For that, we need a number of input parameters. For instance, we need the bathymetry, that is the different depth of the reservoir, as we can see in the first image. The red color is that there the depth is higher. We need the initial conditions and parameters from tributaries. Tributaries are the different rivers that come into the reservoir. And for that, we need the flow of that river, the temperature that goes to the river, and the salinity, for instance. And other different meteorological parameters, like the rain, the temperature of the air, the humidity, solar radiation, wind, etc. And there are very hard interrelations between the parts. The goal for this first model is to reproduce the thermocline and water level. The thermocline is the different temperature in the water column, as we can see in the first chart. We got very good results. This is the values taken by the model versus the real data, and the results are quite okay. The water level also is important to know more or less the volume of the water that we have in the reservoir, and it can be seen here in the second chart. So the second model is the water quality, that is more complex. Due to the number of processes involved, we are talking about like 30 different processes and a lot of parameters, and it's very hard to try to reproduce the altitude. For example, as input, we need the hydrodynamic output from the first model. We need not concentration, both and initially in the water reservoir and also the tributaries. For that, we need parameters like nitrogen, phosphorus, and so. We need also an initial algae concentration. We need the different sediments that are in the reservoir, and a number of other competing ratios like the mortality of the algae, the growth ratio, etc. So, to do that, we try to model it increasingly, adding parameters one by one, oxygen, after nutrients. The model is not yet validated because of some problems. For instance, the oxygen is not yet well distributed in the water column, comparing the model with the real data. The nutrients are not working as we expected. and the LD trained to do that. To solve that problem, we need to calibrate the model. And to do so, to try a lot of different scenarios with different ratios, with different parameters of different algae. So we need a sweep. And we need to run many different models with some small changes. So we need, after that, analyze the results. And for instance, I think Ophelia could be one of the tools that we can use to analyze the results, and in particular, to try to see what is the relationship between different parameters and how they are working together. So, regarding the implementation strategy, the first component that we would like to test is one data. This is a key component because we need a storage distribution solution. We are working with a company and we are not in the same place. So, first of all, we need a system that can be distributed, and we from IFCA we can access that, and the people from the company also could access. And it should be linked also to the computing part. So everything in a distribution solution could be connected. For instance, we will upload the input, the computing node, for instance, a Docker could also mount that system file and access to the input and write the outputs, and after that, we as users could be accessed with that sharing capabilities that one data has. The input and output files are up to 50 gigabytes, so I don't know if it could be a problem. Let's see when we try. And I propose a schedule of tests with one data. First of all, we have a Docker file that launch a DirectVD instance and try to run a model. We would like to create one data, a one data space to put the input files, and it should be accessible by that Docker. After that, we would like to test with different things. First of all, with one model. After that, add the parameter sweep. That is a sweep that can be run another models. And after that, test with an model and check the outputs. The second tool that we could use is Ophelia, that we found that it could be very interesting for us. We want to model the output. We have a number of parameters in time and space, so I think we could use Ophelia to analyze that output. We would like to test and to check what is the interaction between parameters, for example, nitrogen versus argon, CO2 versus oxygen, etc. And we have parameters not only in time, but also in space and time, because the model is a 3D model. And we can get different values in different points of the reservoir and also in the water column. The schedule for this tool should be, first of all, test with one param in time. After that, test with more, like 2 or 5. And after that, try to use the Ophelia with 2D and 3D data of the reservoir, the output of the model. The third tool that we could use is Kepler. The output of the model must be analyzed after being completed. So I think we could use Kepler to optimize to the analysis of the output of the model. Right now we have an R script that analyzes the thermoclines that I showed before with the data of the model and the real data. I think Kepler could fit on this. We could make a workflow that takes the output of the model. And as I saw here in the schedule, first of all, we could try to make a workflow to run the script with an input file. After that, we could try to compare that input file with real data. The real data is now stored in a MySQL database. And after that, that I think is very ambitious for this week, is to link the output that is now in a Docker with Kepler. This is a schema of the current architecture of the case study on how good that tools fit in that system. So, I don't have if you have a point. So, we have here an ICT expert that is the person who runs the parameter sweep. We have the repository with the Docker file or so on, and it goes to the computing part. For that, we have different running instances with that runs a number of models, and that running instances access to the input files that are in a one data space, and the model is run and it writes an output. The output is stored also in the one data space and are accessible by, for instance, a bio expert from the company that can test and check if the output is okay. The other things that we can do is use that output with a PDA or with Kepler, which is from the spacing in one day. Well, I had another case study, but in this case, I think only one data would help to do it. So I thought that the best case study to work is the algorithm. So that's it from my part. If you have any questions.
Thank you very much, Fernando. Any questions to Fernando or comments?
Sure.
Yeah.
Thoughts on your parameters suite. Mm-hmm. So are you going to be implementing it?
Yeah.
So how are you going to do it?
Well, we have a very basic script with different. Well, we have a configuration file that is the file that says which parameters should be changed in the model, and a shell script that runs the different kinds of model. It is. We have two versions, one that is connected with our supercomputer at IFCA that runs a number of jobs, and after that it takes the output, and we are trying to implement it to work with Docker. It should be run one Docker for every model that you want to run, and after that get the result that is only being there.
Okay. So what about the performance overhead of using Docker?
Sorry.
Simon, can you speak? Can you because we have just set the environment on the microphone for the streaming. So if you can increase the volume of your.
No problem. So so what's the performance overhead of using Docker? Are you setting up running?
We have to talk because it's a case for Indigo that actually I have to talk with Marika about it because it is not yet tested. So we are developing it and we are not yet.
Note that
Docker
image is can be prefetched on the compute nodes. So you are only, you need some seconds to start the Docker container.
Microseconds.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, the reason why I'm asking is I'm always looking for ways of minimizing anything that's not doing the computing. You know, so if you're setting up a virtual machine once,
yeah,
then,
sure.
Then are you reusing that virtual machine as part of the parameter suite, or are you just setting up a bunch of virtual machines with parallels around?
Okay, in our architecture, we have different slaves that are virtual machines that are already running. And inside those virtual machines, we have Docker engine that is working, of course, as a daemon. And we have we can have Docker images for the use cases prefetched, pre-downloaded. So as soon as a new job is submitted, a new Docker container is immediately started. Actually, I have prepared a proof of concept demo for this use case, starting from the Docker file that Fernando provided me. I just rearranged something to shrink the Docker image size and to move the running part away from the Docker itself, because inside the Docker image there should be only the software, and I have a simple script, a bash script that runs the executable which is inside the Docker image. For the moment, I have mounted one data only for the output because, for a time reason, I'm using the input data that are inside the Docker image, but it's simple to extract the input data reference from the image and put them inside an input one data space. So if there is time later, I can show this demo.
We can make a slot just before lunch for this. I have a comment. At some point, Fernando, you said that I don't know if you can manage to integrate Kepler with this. Try to make a time schedule of what you want to do in the next days and profit, for example, from the fact that Michael is here now. So you can integrate Kepler even later when you are when you are back home. But since Michael is there now, maybe you could profit of his presence to see what's needed, just to dig into the problem and see what's needed. So the big advantage of having developers of the tools and be responsible for the use cases here is that you should profit as much as possible of the time you can spend here. Yeah.
Good. Just as a follow-on, this is kind of a challenge for using workflow.
Yes.
I tend to see when workflow is used is that you've got a task, then another task, then another task. And within these tasks, there's a whole load of initialization that's going on that's not useful computation time. And I'd like to put out as a challenge there, is it possible to have other workflow which is doing the setup and initialization before the compute tasks are ready to go? So it's basically doing as much initialization in parallel where other workflows are doing other things like data transfer or whatever. So when you're actually ready to do the computational part, there's no setup time whatsoever. You're straight in, getting the maximum amount of parallel. And all the other initialization is sort of hidden as you're doing other preparatory tasks, like data cleansing or something like that. So anybody who's using workflow, just think, you know, is there anything that you can be doing in parallel to minimize the overhead for initialization, communication, or anything like that?
Mikael, any comments on this? If this can be done to almost parallel, because it should not be exactly parallel, but to almost parallel workflow that do what Simon is.
Well, it's possible, of course. Well, inside the workflow, which runs in parallel, you can make components. You can say that each component is running parallel, and they all will do something. And then eventually, after the space is finished, you have like setup ready. So.
Yeah. Absolutely. I'm going to say, when people do workflow, they tend to be task oriented.
Yeah.
And they forget that there's a whole lot of stuff going on around that task that you could then pipeline and then do parallel pipeline. So I'm greatly complaining, and it's just for students who are thinking about using workflow, just to think about what's actually going on in that task and how much you could overlap that task to another task, just to save a bit more, you know, processing time or setup time, just to get maximum speed up from the workflow.
Well, technically possible. The question is how people think about this approach and whether they take into account if they can parallelize them. And that's it.
It's a great challenge.
Yeah. I
bet. Indeed.
Any other questions, Bruce?
This is one from Marika, actually. So just thinking about the setup, Tosca can be used to set up the to orchestrate the various things. Is there a Kepler component for Tosca?
It will be possible because the all the things submitted to the task orchestrator is a task template.
Okay.
So also the interaction among the portal, the feature gateway, and the orchestrator is under the through task
orchestrator. Okay.
Yeah, but
you're gonna see that.
Mikkel said yesterday, you can use Tosca in the graphic way as a present in the presentation mode because you wanna interact
in Kepler.
You can use Kepler, sorry. Okay. Or you can demand the execution of a workflow to Kepler somewhere and you take results. So it's actually it's use case driven. So maybe people can prefer to get their Kepler to draw, to sketch the workflow and push a button. Or to deploy a container with Kepler, pass to it a workflow and run it.
I'm getting confused there. So where does the user write their orchestration? Because, I mean, both of these are
orchestration. Or workflow?
Orchestration. Okay. So you say, listen, you know, for my workflow to run, I need the following services. That sounds like a job for Tosca. Sounds like something that I would usually do with Ansible. So you deploy these things and now they're ready, and then the workflow runs inside of those. So I'm confused about, you know, where do I tell Tosca to do things and where do I tell Kepler to do things? As a user, like, where am I supposed to write these things?
Well, if you're using your own interface, I mean, usually it's something that you do in the interface. So for example, you imagine that you have a portal, you have the future
game. I've got a definition of a set of things that need to get done, and it's like a topology of tasks. Some of them may be repeating, some of them may wait for data, and so on. That sounds like something that you can.
That's a workflow.
That's a workflow.
Then you use.
Yeah, but that workflow implies a service orchestration, because to execute the workflow, you need the various services to be plugged into each other.
I don't think that nothing prevents you to have steps in Kepler. That's called the future gateway.
That's exactly
Tosca.
What I mean. So, like those blocks, you know, let's say part of my workflow is, okay, go deploy this cluster. Is that available?
But usually this is something that the future gateway can do calling Tosca.
Yeah.
But then you can create a brick of Kepler, as Mikkel showed yesterday, right, for the other actions involving the future gateway that does exactly this.
All right, so one of my actors is going to be a Tosca actor, am I right?
Take into consideration that users that access the Indigo platform through the portal will never see the details of a Tosca template because the complexity of the Tosca template will be hidden through the portal, the future gateway.
Yeah, but someone has to define that somehow.
Yes, and this will be a duty of the scientific community,
the application
with the help of the GRA people.
Yeah, sure.
So we will help the champions to build this Tosca template, but the final users from the scientific community.
I'm not worried about that.
Will see only the portal and click and then insert the input parameters that will be then translated into a call to the orchestrator through the future gateway with a template and a set of parameters. to customize the template.
Yeah, sure. So I mean, I'm not worried about the user interaction. I'm worried about the development of the entire thing. And so, I mean, I think I've got a bit of a clear understanding, because it sounds like to me you've got to build a workflow that includes some orchestration, because you need to define how this workflow is supposed to get executed. And so that implies that there's a Tosca actor, which is called by a feature gateway to say, like, go orchestrate things, and when my jobs come down, they can run.
Yeah, because the task orchestrator implements Tosca runtime that is able to pass the Tosca template and start the deployment workflow.
Right. Okay.
It is very complex because in our case, in the Indigo platform, we have many actors, many components that are in charge of different features provided to the user. Monitoring, accounting, data locality, data management, and so on.
This is all
hidden to the final user.
Better be hidden.
I'm sorry to interrupt this, but we have days to go into these details, and we need to move on with the program to give all the speakers the opportunity to present the use cases. So I will thank again Fernando. Thank you very much. And now we're going to have two presentations from Astrophysics. The first one is about distributed archive system for the Cherenkov telescope array, and the speaker is Eva Sciacca from the Italian National Institute of Astrophysics and the Astrophysical Observatory of Catania. So okay.
Thank you. Okay, hello everyone. My name is Eva Sciacca. I'm a postdoc at the Italian National Institute of Astrophysics and I work at the Observatory of Catania. And I will present this use case for the distributed artifact system for the 7th of Telescope Array project. We are developing with our colleagues at the Observatory of Rome. Galloxi and Antonelli, and for Catania there is me and my colleague Alessandro Costa. So basically this is the outline of the talk. I will present the Sci-GaIA telescope array project, so what is, who is involved, and which are the main aims of the project. Then I will talk about the data requirements, data life cycle, and the data model. Then the overview of the archive system and what's the proposed solution for the archive system using the Indigo Data Cloud project technologies. So what is CTA? CTA is a big initiative to build the world's largest and most sensitive ground-based high-energy gamma-ray observatory. The main scientific aims of these initiatives are mainly to investigate high energy gamma rays to understand the origin of cosmic rays and their role in the universe, to understand the nature and the variety of the particle acceleration around the black holes, and to search for the ultimate nature and physics beyond the standard models. How it is going to be built? We are foreseeing several telescope arrays distributed in two sites, one north site and the other south site, which have been identified in the Canary Islands and in Scilla. We are expecting to use three kinds of Sci-GaIA type telescopes, small size, medium size, and large size. And as regarding the prototypal activities we are doing within the CTA, two big projects have been funded from the Italian Ministry. Those projects are the ASTRI flagship project and the mini array project. Within the ASTRI project, we are building a prototype for the small size telescope array, which is located in the site of Serra Nave, which is here up to the Etna mountain, and we are which is close to the end. And now we are going to build an array of these small size telescopes in the CTA sites. Who is involved? So CTA, since the beginning of its conception in 2008, has been identified within the ESPRI project, so within the European Strategy Forum on Research Infrastructures. Because of the main worldwide involvement, we have 31 countries participating, more than 1,000 of participants, and more than hundreds of institutes. So this is why we have this big initiative. And why we are using this kind of telescopes, because they are they have a deeper sensitivity with a factor greater than 10, and we are foreseeing to discover more than 1,000 of new gamma ray sources within the end of the project. The project will last for at least 20 years. I mean, from the beginning was 30 years. And the data requirements we are foreseeing are in the range of petabytes per year. But this is the optimistic scenario, since by now we don't know which will be, for example, the camera resolution, so which are the specific technologies which are going to implement the real telescopes. So in the optimistic scenario, we will have to handle tens of petabytes, but they are going to be maybe much more, hundreds of petabytes per year. These estimates are calculated based on the prototyping activities we have been doing for the ASTRI and the ASTRI MinAarray projects. We have then to handle several levels of data, going from the raw data coming from the telescopes, then the calibrated data coming from each separate camera, the reconstructed data showing the shower parameters per event, such as the energy, the direction, the particle identifier, and so on. Then we have the reduced data, which are the sets of the selected events. And then from this data, we are going to do science. So get the high-level BNET data products, such as the spectra, the sky maps, and the light groups. And then all this data have to be preserved and available to the scientists in the astronomical standards. So the CDA archive and architecture is going to be configured as a real observatory, where the scientific community is going to get the data products in the virtual observatory data standards. They are going to submit proposals to the Science Operations Center, which will take care of the proposal handling, the science management, and the operation planning. Then the proposals are scheduled for the telescope operations, the data acquisition, and then we will have to handle the performance monitoring, the on-site analysis execution. Then all the data reduction and Monte Carlo pipelines will be performed to through fast giant network, and then being published via the Science Data Center through the virtual observatory standards. So we are foreseeing two kind of archives, one on-site, so on each telescope, and one off-site, which is going to manage all data coming from the telescopes array. Basically, we will have the same structure for the on-site archive and the off-site archive. And the main standards adopted to implement it are based on the Open Archive Information System, where we foresee five units, the ingest units, which involves the collection of the software and the middleware able to receive the bulk of data coming from the array. Then the storage, which guarantees the efficient retrieval and ingestion of the data. The administration unit, which deals with all the operations for the CDA archive system and its management, also assuring the performance and that all the requirements are fulfilled. Then we have the access unit, which consists of the collection of software and the online services to provide the efficient access to the CDA data and to the CDA components. And then finally the data transfer unit, which guarantees the transfer of data between the on-site archive and the off-site archive system. So this is the architecture, deployment architecture we are foreseeing starting from the prototyping activities. For the ASTRI prototype, we said we are building just a unit, one telescope, small size, So we just need a single mirrored archive system, and this is, has been done. And starting from the experiences we gained for this prototype, we are going to develop for the Astri Mini Array a distributed system. So for this, we gain, the, of course, the data model, and the demo the data model we have built for the Astri prototype. And thanks to the Invitgo Data Cloud project collaboration, we would like to develop a distributed archive system using the One Data platform. After this project, we will be able to present the results to the CTA Observatory for the off-site archive solution, because it will be able to deploy a federation of different storages to handle this large amount, this big amount of data. So to resume, the requirements for the archive are the bandwidth, so an efficient, fast and high throughput, and low latency connection. And then we need for the computing an efficient and managed query system to run the jobs to reduce data. The storage should be easily horizontal or scalable for long term and to be silent for corruption free, and then easy access to this data. So the distributed archive system will have for us several advantages, starting from the lower cost with respect to the single huge data center, and easy manageability and maintenance, also regarding human resources. A distributed database also involving the metadata of the architect of the data architecture, and easy scalability for adding new nodes to the system, and disaster recovery free by different size redundancy of data. For the data model, we are focusing on the data model that are being developed during the Astri project. In this case, we have several databases handling the proposals, the user access, the data itself, the calibration and monitoring. For a first prototype, we are exporting the metadata related to the data itself, and we are trying to port this relational database to the coach base database, which is the one embedded in the One Data solution. For the data model, this is just a sample data model in which we have to describe, for example, the path for the physical file, then the physical file name or the origin ID, and this should be connected to the proposal ID and the user ID related to the proposal. Okay, so this is the overview of the architecture, and now I'm going to detail the implementation plan we are foreseeing during this collaboration with the Indigo project. So we are foreseeing the first realization prototype phase, in which we would like to create two distributed resources, one located at INF and one located at ENFN, populated with terabytes of data coming from simulated data and real datasets of the CTA prototypes. Then we would like to federate these resources using the Indigo tools, such as the One Data platform. Okay, develop the schemaless database to describe the metadata for the simulated and real datasets. Also, we would like to test the Indigo solutions for authentication and authorization related to the archive, and maybe implement other tools related to the visualization or the management for the data providers. For the second realization phase, so the pre-production phase, we would like to add the grid infrastructure to the archive. So migrating the repositories to grid-enabled sites, such as the one located at the NFN in Frascati, to enable the computations directly from the CTA archive, and again federate the prototype archive. Expand the computation and storage in order to be compliant with the pre-production of the CTA project. And also in a final step, to enable the access of the archive from the CTA tools, such as the CTA Science Gateway and the proposal handling platform, which is being developed. For the purposes of this event, we have been in contact with the One Data team. So we were thinking to start with a very basic configuration of One Data installed in a virtual machine using Docker and Docker Compose. We have found on GitHub there are several useful scripts to start this configuration, having the pre-configured one provider and one zone. And we would like to ingest some sample CTA dataset coming from the ASTRI project, and we would like to configure a sample data model on the One Data embedded database, which is based on Couchbase. And we have seen now it's possible to be done with the CDMI, so we would like to do this. And we would like to just write sample queries for accessing the data on One Data. So if you have questions.
Oh, thank you very much. Questions? I got one. It's the same question I asked the previous speaker. Is there anything of your job that of your work that could be put in a workflow? Are you going to explore workflows
maybe
or
we
the
will,
single?
Exploit some workflows for the high-level analysis of data. So now we are concentrating on the storage of raw data, but maybe in the later step we are focusing on workflow management for high level analysis of data. I don't know for the pipeline and the raw data if they are going to use workflow technologies.
Any other questions?
Yes,
I yep.
Why do you
prefer
grid technologies rather than cloud technologies?
I know that they have strict requirements for grid because they are using right now the grid equipped with GPUs. So they need specific infrastructure right now. But maybe in the future we would like to use cloud technologies, maybe for data. And then we have to interact with the platform where the computations are executed.
One of the requirements.
Alessandro, speak louder.
One of the requirements of the CTA community was the use of grid technology, and in particular the Dirac technology. This is a de facto standard in our community. So
I don't know if it is going to change.
It has been decided to work on this infrastructure. That's all.
No, then it was simply curious. Yes.
It is a requirement.
Yes,
but now it's a requirement.
Any other questions? Okay, if not, let's thank him again. And then we move to the second presentation about astrophysics that will be given by Elisa Mondero, same National Institute of Astrophysics, but Observatory of Trieste, and she will tell us about astronomical data format integration into Ophidia. Let's switch this.
During the follow of the next 2 days, I will also collaborate here with Alessandro Danca from CMCC. We heard the video presentation yesterday from him. And also, I'm working with Cristina Knapic at Trieste Observatory and with Sandro Fiore at CMCC Lecce. So today, I will present this use case about the integration of an astronomical data format into Ophidia. So this is the outline. I will first explain what we are doing in Trieste, or let's say part of what we are doing in Trieste about archiving. I will introduce briefly the fixed format, and then I will explain what is our role here during the next 2 days. And we present a short implementation strategy with some points, and then I will jump over to rooms. So, at Trieste Observatory, I'm working within the AI2 project, which is the Italian Astronomical Archive project, and basically they developed an archive system, so they have a lot of they gather data from different observatories scattered around the world, and so they are basically conserving, collecting the data, storing them, checking that the data is correct, and also deploying the data and making them available to the final user. So it's about data curation and preservation. It's not only for research purposes, but also for didactic purposes. And they provide services and tools to do this, from the initial collection of the data to the to making them available to the final user. And then it's also about data publication, for example, in the virtual observatory. The data that they collect are from several sources. It's from telescopes, for example, the LBT, Asiago Telescope, or Telescopio Nazionale Galileo, and they come also from simulations. So they deal with a huge amount of data every year, and the format that is usually the standard archival format for astronomical data is the FITS, Flexible Image Transport System. And this kind of file is, the structure is pictured here. So it has a primary HBU, which is made up by the header, which is fixed text file, and an array of binary data. And then this HBU is also, can be repeated, so you have, you can have more than one extension. The dimension of the array is given by the keyword and axis, which is reported in the header. And the feeds that we get from CCDs, they just map a portion of sky. So basically we have an axis equal to 2, so it's a two-dimensional matrix. And there are some operations that need to be done on these row fits, which are listed here. It's dark subtraction, flat field correction, and bias offset calibration. So the first is due to the fact that when we have long exposure times, we need to take into consideration this that subtraction. So we need an additional image which is taken with the shutter close. And the flat field correction is basically improve the quality of the image by removing some artifacts that are caused by a different pixel sensitivity. And the bias offset calibration is due to the fact that we want to remove the electronic noise. So always before making something available to the astronomer, the research, we have to go through this reduction sequence. And so our aim here during these 2 days is to start to work on using Ophelia to perform this data reduction. So the motivation for choosing Ophelia is that we deal with big data, as I explained before. We deal with a huge amount of images every night. And the second motivation is that the fixed file can be much more general. So if you generalize this n axis to n instead of 2, then you get something similar to what we saw yesterday. Yesterday, for example, during the video presentation, we saw the mapping of the temperature on a spot on the globe. So we had latitude, longitude, altitude, and temperature, and the month. And here, if we have an axis equal to 2, so we have just two spatial, let's say, x and y, and the intensity. So it may look trivial compared to something that is was so complex yesterday, and especially here we missed the time series. But as I said, this FITS format may be much more general. So we have some FITS coming from other sources. They have, for example, the energy. They have the time, and also two spatial coordinates. But for now, we want to start to work on this much more simple fits with an axis equal to 2, because it is what we need for archiving purposes. So it is what we get from CCDs, basically. So first, we will focus on data import in Ophidia. And then we will exploit the Ophidia strength for this data reduction. So what we want to do in practice during the 2 next days is to, first of all, find out the tools needed to manipulate the fits. So it's binary data, so we need to dump them into usable human-readable format. We need to find out libraries for reading and writing fits in C. Ophidia is written in C, and we need to analyze which operations are required to perform the data reduction, and if they are available, to use the available operators and or implement them if they are not already there. You may remember that yesterday we saw a number of functions that like logarithm or the exponential by which it was possible to manipulate the data. And as I said before, we don't have time series here, so we need to find a suitable way to partition our data. Okay, so in conclusion, I introduced to you the what are the main issues in archiving images in astronomy, and what are the procedures that we need to go through in order to give to the final user some product that is usable. And so our use case will be about integrating this fixed format in Ophidia, and there is also from the Ophidia side developer side interesting basically having more and more formats that can be read, so to extend the field from, I don't know, the climate change issues to also astronomy and so on. And we also, for future developments, we would like to implement, we would like to use fits basically with that are a dimension greater than 2. So thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. Questions? Comments? I'm curious, what is the user interface? You have a portal, you have the comma line. What kind of user interface you will provide your users?
I think that can be done directly from the user interface provided by Ophidia.
Okay.
So the user will just load
the data? And
yes.
Okay. Other questions? Okay, so if not, let's thank again Elisa, and then we move to the next presentation that is about collaborative knowledge discovery environment on biodiversity and linguistic diversity. And I don't know who's gonna make the presentation. It's actually, I got 3 speakers, Evelyn Badabort, Senia Zaitseva, is if I'm pronouncing correctly,
yeah.
And Deborah Ostrich from the Austrian Academy of Science. You're using your computer, so you need this one? You need the adapter? If you are swapping the speakers, please change also the microphone.
Okay.
So yeah, if you stop, yes. And you should stay on from this side on, otherwise you will
not be able to come.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Okay.
Okay.
But you should stand.
As you wish. As you wish.
Finally, we have it. Okay. Thank you very much. Is it automatic? So we are a team of the Austrian Academy of Sciences, working at the Austrian Center for Digital Humanities. So what we are now telling you comes from the humanities area, but it is interconnected to the sciences. Roberto was already connecting the speakers and inviting the speakers. So. the project is as well a project that is somehow connected to the COST Action European Network of E-Lexicography. I do not know whether you are accustomed to what COST Actions are. That is why I want to say some words about that as well. COST Actions are interdisciplinary actions that are funded by the European Commission to bring together scholars of different disciplines and especially work on, let's say, things that are not in a certain discipline but enlarge the topic of disciplines and see how people from different areas can work together and proceed into new fields. And within the this is one of the topics we are dealing with, to explore new methods in lexicography. So, what we now want to give it as an outline is to have the scientific problem on one hand, that is what I will introduce to you, then Xenia will tell you a little bit about the proposed solution, the data model and the data space, and finally Davor will introduce a little bit into the architecture and what we are going to use of the tools and services we have seen here so far. And we are quite happy if you get feedback from you, what you would suggest us to do as well and contribute to this. So the main thing that we are working on is a collaborative framework for people from different disciplines. Our users are mainly people that are coming from lexicography right now. So these are people mainly that are not very well accustomed actually to coding or to technologies. So we really try to bridge the gap from, let's say, research infrastructures on one hand, make use of what is available on one hand, and on the other hand, bringing researchers that are doing quite traditional ways of developing lexical resources. And we were choosing for this hackathon topic of biodiversity and linguistic diversity, so we have a lot of heterogeneous data and we are working especially on plant names. So actually we are mainly focusing common names for plants in different languages. So this is a multilingual project and multicultural project, because in plant names you have quite a lot of references to cultural topics and resources, how they were used for example in the different cultures. And the other thing, we have the scientific names, so the usual Latin names right now, and mainly as a reference point for lexicography, and we try to find a connection. And as we have actually had in our first talk a little bit of the genome, so that would be the next step to even connect with this kind of new research and new naming concepts. So what we often have as a problem, or what is the core of the problem, is that lexicography results, actually the dictionaries are the reference dictionaries for, or the reference points for the work, but there is a gap in making use of most recent knowledge. This is what we want to bridge, that let's say the knowledge that is coming from taxonomists is immediately to be used for lexicographers and linguists, so that there is a common exchange and collaboration actually. So this is a framework we want to establish, and there is another lack of reusing data. Dictionaries that are built in a traditional way are very often not easily to be reused, or the data of them are not easily to be reused in different surroundings. So this is something we want to overcome as well with our solution. And the third thing is, as I've started actually in the beginning, there is a lack of making use of infrastructures for curating data, for bringing data together, for interlinking data, for publishing and sharing the data so far. So this is especially relevant, but not just for the small lexicographic initiative. Well, it is especially relevant for very small ones, and for the very big, where it is just a really big endeavor to do so, and it's costing a lot of money and energy to do so. So we are really speaking about lexicographies, endeavors that are 100 years old, or big projects with big teams, where this means not just the technological development, but even as well a big social change and transformation process. So, thank you.
I will continue with proposed solution. We work on development of integrated environmental portal for biodiversity and UC diversity. And our goals is to establish tools and services for resource discovery and what we can offer, what we have in academy, and also external resources and databases which provide data on plant names, and also embed research institutions which work in biological domain because they also provide this data. We want to establish a workspace for storage of resources, establish long-term preservation practices. One of our main goals is to create a collaborative environment that researchers from different institutions can work on the same data and share their data and reuse and establish networks. Yes, we also work already with Common Name Service. It's a service established in Natural History Museum of Vienna, and it's a service which aggregates, which provides a federated search for roughly 20 external databases from other countries, and it provides you all common names for one Latin name. So we establish a service on top of common names which gives you back for all your Latin names, all the matched alternative labels. And of course, we aim to work with semantic data, so we want to provide a tuple store and to model data in RTF in order to make retrieval in the best way as much as we can, because there are a lot of questions on what Latin name should be used, and Latin names have many synonyms, and this data is not available very easy online, so we want to provide these tools and make it much more transparent for researchers and also for them to share their expertise. And yeah, so we also want to provide visualization where data comes from each dialect name and the region it comes from. So about our resources, for now we have a data set coming from DBO database. It's a database containing roughly like 2 million records on dialect names in the Bavarian region. And we work with the subset of Latin names, and the model is SCOS Excel. And we model Latin names as a preferred label, as a top concept, and all common names as alternative. We aim to extend more in the future to a lexical data model using Ontolex data model, maybe, because we also have data on headword and lemma of each common name. That would be good for building, like, let's say, more dictionary type of data. And yes. So our vision of our platform or portal, it's all plants of the world with all common scientific names. And I already said about our data set. So for now we have data from DBO, and we also established connections with other institutions or for training other languages, Russian, Chinese, Japanese, and African. And we want to also provide resources for linking your common names via Latin names to AgroVolk, Wikidata, and Europeana as much as possible.
Story about idea and data model, and how we plan to implement this. So we identify a couple of software components. That's a catalog. Catalog is something that users can browse and discover plant names, languages, common names, locations. And then we have a workspace. Could be private, shared, or public. Catalog would be in public workspace, so everybody will be able to browse it. While in a private workspace, users will be able to curate data, to collect data, make virtual collections, and share with other groups. So private and share are for authorized groups of people or individuals. Then we have enrichment services. This is questionable, so it's still, we have to decide, is it something that we'll run on our server, or it's something that we can run on your platform. We need a repository for long-term preservation. Xenia already told you about Tribal Store, where we'll keep relations between plants, languages, and concepts. We'll need visualization services. And we need authentication and authorization. So this is a top overview of our infrastructure. Any can browse and discover data, but only authorized users could collect this data, make private virtual collections. They can use curate service. They can publish data. When data is published, one part goes to repository and the other goes to Tribal Store, so it's kind of enrichment from the user side. Then we have visualization service, which will visualize what users browse. Catalog, well, our vision is to be something with faceted search or full text search. Then we have enrichment layer. In enrichment layer, we have a couple of services enrich your data, can connect them and link from different different reference platforms like Common Name Services, Wikidata, and Eurodata. So in this part, what we want to solve, the problem is that there are plants with the same plant with different Latin names. So this is work of biologists. What we have to provide for them is a kind of similarity between two plants, comparing all common names. What we already have is enrichment service, which enriches data with common name service. We have Tribal Store, curating service, collaborative curating service is also implemented. You can use it. And what we need is we have to implement this web interface. So we have to see with you what you can offer. It could be some kind of portal, but we'll see later. We need a place to run Tribal Store repository, as I understood you already have it, so we can use it. And enrichment service is something we should talk about. So, as I said, are we going to run it on your machines or on our server? This is something we could use from you, Future Gateway, Indigo, Platform as a Service, and G-Library and Open Access Repository. So that would be all. Any questions so far?
Okay, thank you very much. So let me understand. So for the Future Gateway there is no problem. For the PAS, could you elaborate on how you want to use? Well, Marika is here, so just to understand.
We need a place to run Tribal Store and enrichment service. So
okay,
we can for enrichment service we can still run it on our servers, and we can just invoke it from the web interface.
Okay.
So.
So you say you have a program, I mean, when you say enrichment, you fetch the metadata and you based on ontology, you create tribals.
Yes.
More or less.
You fetch data, actually.
Okay.
So you can get it in JSON, and we can publish it under CC0.
Okay.
So it goes to the tribal stuff.
Okay.
And people can browse it.
And just to understand the complexity, how many machines, I mean, this triplification, mm-hmm. in terms of computing needs and storage needs, I mean...
Well, it's not so needy, I would say. I don't expect much of users,
okay.
not at the beginning. Yeah, okay. Senia, can you say something about numbers?
Yeah, I just want to add about this envision, because that's the part of the workflow. User comes with his data,
okay.
and we want user to have Latin name, because it's the top concept, and that's how we match dialects. That's the translation through Latin name. Then he does enrichment, so he gets the data from the servers, from the API, the CNS, and then we have to establish again the workflow, how he can match his Latin name with his ID coming from his database with the CNS, because it's the same string, it's the same Latin name in many cases, but it's different IDs, and we want to preserve provenance information. So, and after this, he published data in Triple Store, and through the Latin names and ontologies we use, you can retrieve already all existing common names in Triple Store from other datasets.
So, now coming to the front end, there are services that are freely available. The user can browse without getting authenticated.
Yes.
And other services like annotation curation or interaction with the open access repository that needs authentication.
Yeah.
Because
if
he's working on his data, it needs some authentication
aspect
as well. Okay. Yeah. So that not everybody can take your.
Yes.
Yeah.
Do you need help to put whatever is needed to run on a cloud? Mm-hmm. Do you have it as a virtual machine, as a container? Do you need help to dockerize this, or you already have this? Because I mean, we're running other containers or virtual machines, right?
Yeah. I have another question also for the enrichment services are long-running services. They should be always up and running, and they should be scalable according to the workload, the user requests.
Mm-hmm. Or is short living?
I think that they're more like a task. So you invoke them, you get data back, and that's it.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And then you kill the machine.
Yeah.
Okay.
Kill the machine.
Are those enrichment services accessed by researchers or by the web portal?
By
researchers.
So it's
directly by researchers.
Yeah. So the idea is you upload your data, you have in your file some Latin names, then you run enrichment services, one of them or all of them or whatever you like, and you get back enriched data. So you have Latin name and you have different dialects and different languages, common names for your.
Okay, so this is one case. So cases you put. I mean, you have an input form, people put something, they press a button, there is something running in the back, and they get some results. So how the data management comes in, the GLibrary and the OER? How you want to what you want to store and why?
Well,
just a move. Okay, got it.
We still have to store configuration files and information about users.
Ah, okay.
But actually, I think that is one of the tricky things, because these people are having their data and we are just fetching some part of the data set, because the collections are big and they just, let's say, want their collection of plant names running via the services, but not all of their data. And then they probably will write it back in their own services.
But the collections are public or private? Are open or closed?
Well, it depends.
Because they're open, I showed yesterday that you can publish, at the end the portal can publish on the open access repository using the API and assign the UIs, and then people can use it. If you have more private things, then maybe you can store or have cloud storage and use GLibrary to keep it the metadata.
So actually, my idea would be to add it a little bit to promote that they are publishing the data. So that is why do it with a small data set. There are the ones that is an example data set and help them to publish them. But anyway, they need to write it back in their repository and work with those data further. So we somehow need both of them.
Okay.
Yes. From my point of view, we need both of it.
From catalog, we can see only public data.
Okay.
So everybody can discover only public data. And what you are doing in your private workspace, it will be visible when you publish your data.
Okay.
So when you publish it, you get kind of publication, and our data will be enriched with your data.
Okay.
So when it's ready, you just publish, and people can see the changes.
Okay.
And we still keep provenance information to know who did it.
Just one quick question.
Benjamin, shout, because we have the environment microphone.
Oh, okay. Just a quick, very quick one. It's about the languages that you said it will be possible to have the names of the plants in different languages. And you actually mentioned African language. Mm-hmm. And so I just want to give you some information about that. Because in Nigeria alone, we have about 220 languages, you know. And so there is no African language, be as it may. So we have, broadly speaking, English language, and then maybe Spanish, and not Italian, but I think French, some.
You got French and Portuguese, I think.
And Portuguese, yes. So we do not, if you want to develop such a tool for Nigeria alone, you're going to have a big problem, just Nigeria alone, with 160 million people. Now, we have to think about other African countries. So we don't have a uniform language, except, you know, those common ones. Yes.
No, for sure, that's what we are aware of. So the first thing is to see that these are just the languages we were pointing at. Are a little bit more language, let's say, areas. It's more like that. I mean, there is not a Russian language. You would have as well dialects within that and varieties, and that's actually what we want to catch with it as well. And that is one of the main topics, to say, to have this cultural diversity that is somehow represented in the languages. So,
yes.
and to really give especially those people that are doing work within that the opportunity to store it and to make it available and to connect it. So this is one of the core topics, let's say the concept behind it, to say, to allow that. And for sure there is not one thing, the first thing would be to connect with researchers in Africa that are doing that, say have the linguist but have the botanist as well, the taxonomist, to see what is going on, what is available there, and further the idea of doing that on one hand, and on the other hand then have probably small dictionaries or whatever, or initiatives that are running and do that. And we just try to say we enable people to do that in that area, because we do have people that we are working together right now, and if there are people here that are interested into that or help us with it, it is fine. We are open to do so. So it is much more about enabling to collaborate and work on that than just saying we are doing the collection. We are not doing the collection of it. We are bringing people together to do that. And that is why it is so much important. It is quite a lot about we are building technologies, and it is building on trust, actually. So that is why I say the social thing is so much important.
Yes.
So it is something that is usually the user groups are not people that are very much familiar with bringing their data in and sharing them. So this is something we really have to work on.
Great. Thank you very much.
Any other question? Yeah, sure.
It's actually interesting because in South Africa, we currently, there's an Android application for recording data, for audio files and stuff like that. You read out some few words and then you record. Mm-hmm. But I think something like this would work, but I think this would work really cool for us. But the only challenge is you know, the speeds of internet in South Africa and some other places are really slow, because you're trying to collect around across 11 languages.
Yeah.
So you've got 11 official South African languages, and to reach some of the people who really would give you the correct dialect and everything for a particular language, mm-hmm. they could just be in the rural area. So So I'm just thinking, this could be a very good tool for us for collection of corpuses. Mm-hmm. Of course, with those few reservations, but I think it's a very good use case.
So I would actually resume the discussion when you will be presenting after lunch, because I think that there are commonalities that could be exploited.
Yeah.
Any other questions or comments to Deborah, Evelyn, and Xenia?
Can I ask one question?
Yeah, of course!
We would like to keep the development on lowest level as possible.
Yeah.
So we already have crucial services and we just need to set them up and make them better. The question is about web interfaces. There's some kind of portal. Do we have something that have all these features, like public private workspace, authentication, authorization, we already have this. Another requirement is to be able to revoke these services, they all have RESTful API.
Yeah, so what technology your portal is based on?
Well, it's a web interface.
So okay, so if, I mean, so if you can call the future gateway REST API from within your portal, you are set. You have seen yesterday a couple of examples already. So it's just a question of setting up a future gateway API server for you and give you some example on how to submit jobs. And then, of course, on in the back end, we need to have either a virtual machine or a container where your code runs.
Yeah.
And then we need to deploy this to make it available in the different sites in Europe and in Africa as well. Right, Bruce?
It's not up to me. I just make the infrastructure work.
Yeah. So, I mean, because if we have a virtual machine or a container, we can run on the cloud using the Indigo PaaS, or we could run also on local plus, or even on the grid, because there are grid sites in Africa. So if this can be a job that just wakes a virtual machine, run your enricher, and then get the data and close it, why not? This can be done also. So I see the need of API server, and you to use the RESTful API of the future gateway, and then the open access repository. You're welcome to use ours, or you can get a clone. This is up to you. You should decide. I mean, we can even install during these days.
Yeah,
if you have a place where we can install the virtual machine containing a clone of the open access repository I showed yesterday, we can do it within the week. Before you leave, it's just a couple of hours work, and then of course you need to customize.
Yeah.
But if you have a virtualizer where we can deploy and run our virtual machine, this can be done. Mm-hmm. You just let us know, and we can do that for you. And then for July, once we get this, I need to understand. Maybe we could see with Antonio how we can.
First we have to decide where we will store it.
Yes.
So maybe we can still use track and store
it
has already RESTful API. Okay, but for web interface we have to develop, right?
I don't know, I understood that you had.
No.
In Indigo we will come up with what we call a general purpose science gateway based on LifeFrame that we are building to demonstrate the APIs. So in Indigo we said, okay, we have the API server, so other portals can use it, even desktop applications like DevClipper, but just to show other communities how to use it, we have also the graphic interface. You were here on Monday, and Ricardo showed that when you start the API server, you can also start the front end, the LifeRay-based portal. So we can use this, and our portal is able to talk with SAM, with the Indigo IAM AI service, and so on. So if you need this, so the API server, you need both the back end, the API server, and the front end. But this can be installed. So these two things can be installed at your premises if you want, or you can use ours. It's up to you to decide. But this is something that we could do in the next days. So the clone of the open access repository and the API server with the front end. Ricardo, are you following this? We can, you can easily install an API server with LifeRay running. Okay, thank you very much. If there are no other questions or comments.
Mika. Very short comment.
Sure.
This year, guys from US presented natural language processing, that will get there. They have some solutions there. I'm not sure whether this is exactly the same thing that you are doing, but I know that they're working on something that, like this. So I can send you article about this one. You can just take a look whether it's something that you are using.
I'm interested in that.
Okay, so I will send just send me emails or provide me with emails and I will send you directly to their sentence.
The best is, we have a web forum. If you can spend 5 minutes to log in on the forum, then you can post your whatever information and we can use the forum as the exchange place for all the information. Otherwise, emails will not reach everybody, will be a mess. Yeah. So, the forum is there, Mikael. There is a link over there. And you can use your federated discourse,
Sci-GaIA.eu. Okay, so I will put
the information. You log in using your federated credentials from your national federation, and you open a post under Summer Hackfest, and then you put all the information you want.
Okay.
So everybody else will reach it.
Okay.
I mean, you will reach everybody else. Okay. Thank you very much. So now, before lunch, we have a little bit ahead of schedule. Marika will rerun the live demo because as far as I understood it's also relevant for what is being said this morning, right?
Live watch is amazing.
Yes. So the floor is yours. Marika, is it better that we record you from your back or from here? What is better? From your back?
Yeah, from your back.
Possiamo spostare la telecamera che lei vuole lavorare sullo schermo.
And just one slide.
Okay, one slide and then we show. Okay. So one slide, you stop 2 minutes and we move the camera. Okay.
Ora.
Una slide e poi spostate la roba.
Ok.
Aspetta.
I showed my previous presentation on the Monday. I would like to show you some demos that are related to one of the use cases supported by Indigo VAS platform. In this specific case, the user is requesting to the Indigo platform the execution of a user application that has been packaged inside a Docker container. And the execution will be dedicated by the orchestrator to the Kronos framework running on top of the system cluster. So the starting point from the user point of view is always the Tosca template that is hidden. is hidden behind the Indigo portal. So the user will see simply a form with some hints about the application that he wants to submit. There will be some fields that where he will be able to insert values for some parameters, input parameters. And also for sweeping the parameters. So in this demo, I will show you a proof of concept concerning the parameter sweep experiment. The Tosca template is built by a collaboration among the scientific communities champions and GRA people coming from the NEO project. Of course, because there are some technicalities that should be hidden to the end users. As I already explained, the Tosca template contains some references to a Docker image that is built again with the help of GRA people. The image is uploaded onto Docker app, which provides a Docker image public index, a public registry. There we have created an organization called the Indigo Data Cloud.
Can I interrupt you for a second?
Yeah.
What is in the container? Is it the application or is it a little bit more complicated than that?
Okay, inside the container, inside the Docker image, we package both the application,
the user so application,
the software that will run, and also other things that are used to run the application inside Indigo.
Okay.
First of all, the one client.
Right,
because this application will, the data will stage in and stage out,
right.
Will be staged in and staged out using one data spaces.
Okay.
So inside the Docker image, we already provide the one client. So this is a technical detail. The Docker file is committed onto GitHub, and every time we commit something on the Docker file, this is automatically built inside the Docker app. So there is an automated build mechanism provided by Docker Hub itself, so that the images are always updated. Okay, once the user has chosen from the portal, the Indigo portal, has chosen the application he wants to deploy, to execute, and once he has staged in the data inside one data, the future gateway calls the orchestrator, submitting a post request that I will show you during this demo. Then the orchestrator is in charge of executing the whole deployment workflow. That means that the orchestrator will interact with many components of the Indigo pass. For example, it will interact with the monitoring pillar to know the status, the health status of the cloud sites where the job will run. And this information will be used by the orchestrator to select the right platform, the right YaaS platform where the job will land. So the orchestrator will choose a Mesos cluster, a site where a Mesos cluster will be deployed. On top of the Mesos cluster, there will be a Kronos framework, and the orchestrator will submit to the Kronos endpoint the job, translating the Tosca definition into the JSON blob that is recognized and passed by Kronos. Then the job will start on one of the slaves that are part of the Mesos cluster. And each job will mount the data space on one data where it can read the input data and write the output data, so that the user will finally retrieve the expected output.
Can you say something about so I see you've got an example here where there's a Mesos cluster.
Yeah.
But as far as I know, the feature gateway can also submit to other kinds of things.
Yeah.
What else could be slotted in there in WQ4 in terms of a site?
It can be it can submit the deployment of virtual infrastructures. For example, on Monday I showed a demo where a Galaxy portal with a batch system as backend is completely automatically deployed through the orchestrator.
Okay.
Starting from a Tosca template.
Can you tell me how? I'm assuming that Saga fits into that somehow.
It's a different level.
Different level.
When we started to communicate with the different infrastructure, we never go to the orchestrator at the moment.
Okay, so the orchestrator doesn't
see Saga. The pass architecture. So you will deploy a pass infrastructure.
Yeah, but the pass infrastructure.
If you want to run a legacy job, the feature gateway can run the legacy job with green. So in that case, let's go to the orchestrator, but with the other two also.
So the orchestrator can only talk to what exactly?
Can talk with the Mesos cluster,
right,
or directly with the cloud management framework like OpenStack,
okay,
and OpenNebula, Amazon,
right,
and so on.
So it's this cloud-specific tool.
Yeah. So I can start with the demo.
Okay. Just a minute, you move the camera.
Sure.
Però adesso sono tocca alla cioè io mi devo scrivere il tempo di No, io ho un mantenitore dell'applicazione. Quindi devo decidere a priori se questo verrà rimesso solo a cloud oppure.
Per me è specifico per quello. Perché questo volevo capire anche quello. Tosca è generico. Scrivo
quello
che scrivo.
E tu lo dovresti prendere. E se io chiedo all'orchestrator di mandare questo là, quest'altro là, se due cose su te non lo capisce.
Infatti prima del sotto del fare con la gestione tutto dell'orchestrator,
quindi
per questo non è dato
così
dal
utente
finale di
scrivere il suo Tosca. No, però si dire, aspetta l'utente usato. L'utente non farà niente. Però
quello che facciamo ora che noi nello studio abbiamo comunque quando un set di Tosca template che sono però parametrizzati,
sì.
Quindi tu accendi il sistema e quindi ti parametri, secondo i parametri il gioco fino a su un altro,
però solo in point cloud.
Sì. Poi tu la stessa applicazione la puoi definire senza Tosca.
Non è una critica, adesso
non
del capire.
Però sempre configurare tutto configurato la stessa applicazione, non con Tosca template, ma utilizzando un point di like, per esempio. E fin tu che in realtà ce la fa, cioè adesso non è.
Ok, ma allora se io devo mantenere un'applicazione che voglio usare tutti, se devo scrivere una parte che fa Tosca, poi un'altra parte che chiede alla feature gateway di sottomettere Saga.
No,
l'utente
c'è.
No, l'utente, però.
Sempre se la mette feature gateway.
Sì, sto
poi sbagliando. Nella conduzione tu che tutti cosa avete prima di fare infrastrutture è l'applicazione. Tu puoi dire che l'applicazione può usare più infrastrutture. L'infrastruttura di partire da una l'infrastruttura di tipo script.
Però aspetta, perché Tosca sottomette direttamente AGIA e point cloud, ma questo è quanto si ha, che ha il plugin.
Ci penso in YouTube, se hai per l'infrastruttura cloud che si possono mettere poi, insomma, tutto il step, non mi fai una massa come nel caso.
Ma perché non lo posso fare?
Perché quanti sai gestisce la cloud,
ah, ok.
invece qua tu dovresti un servizio complesso
di sostanza.
Come si sente, dici dammi questa macchina entrare, quest'altra, come si
chiede. First of all, I want to show you the test template just to have an idea of what it contains. This is a YAML file that contains the topology description of the job that we want to run. In this case, since we are talking about parameter sweep test, this file contains the description of more than one job. So there is an input section where the user where an input section where there are some parameters that are needed to customize the template and the submission of this template. So for example, the token that is needed to access, to mount the user data space where the input files and the output files will be written. Then there are other parameters like the input path, the output path for each of the jobs, the file name of the product that will be generated by the job, the number of cores and the quantity of RAM that is needed to run the job, and the Docker image that will be used to run this job. And then there is, in this case, the parameter that we want to sweep. In this case, we have the temperature parameter that can be valued with three different values. And then there is the specification, the definition of the jobs, the nodes of the jobs that simply relates the properties of the job with the input parameters. In this case, I will use a Docker image that I have built starting from the one provided me by Fernando. This is built starting from this Docker file. Okay, this is the. This Docker file starts from an Ubuntu trusty image, base image. Then there are a lot of instructions that are needed to compile and to build the software that is needed by the job. There are some tricks that I have of course implemented to shrink the image since the original one was 2 gigabyte size, and this is 1 gigabyte. So I think that we can optimize the image further. So I have then a simple script that is used to run. It's a Rambler script. This one that is used to run the application. Inside this script, which is a wrapper, I first of all mount the input and output data spaces, and then I run. I change the temperature field This is done for the parameter suite. So I have as environment variable the temperature that is changed inside the input file on the fly. And then I run the software. So I can show you the submission. Okay, to submit the job to the orchestrator, I use the deployments endpoint of the orchestrator. In the body of the request, we need to put the input parameters. In this case, I need one data token, so I go to one data web V to fetch the token, the client token.
Can't you get a token programmatically instead of getting
In this case, the user will be prompted to insert the token inside the right. Indigo platform portal.
Okay, so the portal can call one data and say
No. The user...
That is cut and paste from the portal.
So you got to leave the portal, go to one data.
You have a link to the portal of one data, get the token, go back to the portal.
It's just what I'm going to do. So I can create a new token of the ones I have already generated. Copy paste inside these two fields. Okay, the output will be generated inside these folders. I can show you my data space, which is hosted by our Recasbari cloud provider, that one provider. So inside my default space, I have this folder where I have the output folder, which is empty. And now I submit the request, where as you can find, you can see here I have the Tosca template that I showed you before. So I send the post request. The orchestrator returns me the UID of the deployment that I can monitor. The deployment is in progress, and in fact I can go to the Kronos web UI where I can see that the tasks are running. One is already completed. Okay, they have just finished. So I can go to the orchestrator and send a GET request. See that the state is complete. And I can retrieve the output, refreshing the page of the one data. user interface. So I have the three folders that correspond to the three models that I have run. And here I have the output that I simply made an archive of the folder with the input and the output just for this proof of concept. You can see that the temperature was different for each run because from the Kronos interface you can browse the I can browse the sandbox of the job and the wrapper script makes a graph at the beginning on the temperature. So in this case the temperature was 5. And the other, for example, this one. The temperature was set to 3. So I can cross-check that the input file was correctly modified according to the input that I set in the request. Here. Okay, so this is my demo. If there are any questions.
I don't really question, but like a comment. Can you go back to the Docker file, please, for the application? So I see you're the maintainer, and
I've written the Docker file.
Yeah, I know, but I'm gonna say something bad about it, so I don't want you to take it personally. we haven't described it in this Hackfest so far, but a tool that we've been using to distribute applications has them pre-built for various architectures.
Yeah.
And so we use Jenkins to do that. Everything inside there. We build the application, run the tests and everything, and then the binaries are put into a repository which can be mounted remotely.
Okay, so, take into consideration that this was a simple proof of concept to be shown because LifeWatch is one of the use cases that we are supporting.
Yeah.
But in the official workflow, what we are currently doing is that we prepare Ansible recipes to install the software. And
this is actually my point. The container, in my opinion, should contain the execution environment, but the application itself needs to be kind of tested outside of the container, because otherwise you have this huge diversion.
You are perfectly right, and this is what we are currently doing. So we are using Ansible to install the packages once they are tested. They are put on some repositories, and then from there they are used to be installed inside the Docker image. So we have the binaries.
They're stored somewhere and they're tested. Okay, so we're also doing that. We're using CVMFS to do that. And the user defines the how to build and test the application. That is done independently of the user. Once all the builds and tests have passed for the various infrastructure targets that you can think of, laptops, GPU-enabled sites, whatever, that gets put into the repo. And then whoever wants to use that can mount it remotely. So you can mount it inside a Docker container. And the only thing you have inside the Docker container is your execution environment, so one client, any input-output clients or middleware clients that you need. But the application is streamed to the site when it's requested. Very similar to what you do with when say Docker runs, pulls down the image, so same thing. And it uses similar concepts of the union file system to just shift the differences. So I reckon we could probably exchange a couple of ideas. I'll show you.
The other important thing is that when the job is submitted to Chronos, Chronos is able to check if the image has changed since the last download.
Yeah, so that's Karen.
This means that a force pull of the image is performed before starting a new container on the same slave.
But they're all running an independent container, right?
Yeah.
So you've got n copies of up to 1 gigabyte. So in our case,
the base image is there and is reused.
Yeah, but it's reused.
Yeah.
It's used like for every job, there's a different copy of the image. So in our case, there's a single copy of the application on the site, and all of the jobs use that because they're just mounted from outside the container. And so the only thing that's actually replicated more than once is the execution environment, which may include the one client and so on. So that's a nice optimization thing. I'll show you what I'm talking about in the lunchtime.
Okay.
It's the same thing.
It's application
inside the space.
Yeah, instead of putting it in CV interface, we could publish it to one data, no different to us. The only difference is the efficiency of which the data is moved. So, you know, and also the client. So instead of having an auto-FS client, you've got a one data client. So it just depends the tooling on the remote side, what's available. If you don't have a one data client, or if you don't have the AutoFS mounted for that particular thing, then you know you won't be able to access the application. So the idea is, okay, you pack all that stuff into the container and just execute the container, and then you're sure that you can have it. So at the moment, we just force the sites that we have, the static sites, they have to mount a single repository. They do that once and they never touch it again. And whenever an application is changed, maybe an optimization is discovered or a new application comes in, that's user driven. The user is the one that drives that. All the testing is automated, and you just see the new application there when you request it. So that's quite nice.
Any other questions before we break for lunch? Okay, so if not, let's thank Marika for announcement. So we break for lunch here, and then we reconvene 2:30. But at 2 o'clock, we will make some interviews close to the football field, outside of the restaurant, okay? Just to change the place. So try to finish your lunch by 2, and in half an hour, we make some interviews, and 2:30.
Yeah,
okay. Okay. So we reconvene here to 2:30. Close it. Yes. So if you want, you can leave.
Sono tutte le applicazioni. Però tu preferisci solo quelle che vuoi.
Okay.
Ma non è installato nel sistema, ma anche nel caso, in questo caso sono
quello che stai
è quello, noi lo usiamo per trasferire la